So I'll talk about designing jack shafts. You've got a couple of options that I think you should look at. This is one way you can do it. So with my swing arm here, this method is a little bit easier with the swing arm because it's narrower here, because you have to kind of fit a lot of stuff in between here. Now keep in mind your frame rail, you're going to have frame rails, vertical and horizontal frame rails. You'll need some brackets that you mount a shaft to. That shaft is going to be mounted on roller bearings. That shaft will have a keyway run through it, and you'll have two sprockets on that shaft. This sprocket here will be driven by the motor, so the chain will come from the motor. It'll drive that sprocket. It'll rotate the shaft. This sprocket here is also keyed to that shaft. That'll rotate, and that'll be what drives your sprocket on your rear tire. So a couple things. These sprockets have to line up, so keep that in mind. So we're going to design this so that that sprocket lines up. This will have to line up with your motor, so we may have to make some adjustments to this as we go to make sure everything lines up. That shouldn't be a big deal to change. So originally I had designed all my swing arms so that this would be mounted on like a bushing, but that has to change now. So a bushing, it doesn't have any rotating parts. It just allows a kind of a reduced friction between mating parts. But for a rotating shaft like this, that's not going to work. So if let's see. Turn that off. So you'll see here's the shaft with a keyway cut through it, and I've got some needle bearings on there. So that other shaft, that other tube that fits inside of there, it is going to ride on those needle bearings. So this shaft can rotate, I'm sorry, so that outside tube can rotate freely around there. The shaft inside can rotate freely. So I'll show you. I got rid of some of those components so we can focus on this. Let's see what that looks like. Okay, so if we explode this, you'll see all the pieces. So there's my swing arm. Now what I did have to do here was I had to go back and take that tube and make it a little bit thicker wall, and then I had to extrude out a pocket for these so these needle bearings fit inside of there. Those needle bearings roll right on that shaft. I've got a couple of brass bushings there to separate my components. There's my sprocket. There's my bearing, and there's a set collar to hold the whole thing together. So when it's all put together, it looks like that. So there's a lot of hidden pieces in there. Again, what will happen is the swing arm, because it's got those little needle bearings inside, it'll allow the swing arm to pivot on the shaft at the same time that the shaft is allowed to rotate. So the shaft that the sprockets are on, it rides on this bearing. So that's one action that's happening, is that those sprockets are rotating. And again, they're keyed on that shaft, so when one sprocket turns, the other sprocket turns. And then the swing arm itself is mounted on those needle bearings, so it can pivot up and down as the shaft is rotating inside. So that's the trick of this. So it's a lot packaged in that small package, but it's very, very compact. These brackets, I just made up some brackets now to mount this. Those will be edited to fit your frame once you get the frame in place. And I did have to make some changes to the swing arm. I had to make this narrower, and what I did was I checked the alignment of this to my driven sprocket, and then I kind of worked my way backwards there. And I did make it symmetrical. It doesn't have to be symmetrical, but for example, the space between that bracket and the sprocket over here is the same as between bracket and sprocket. That doesn't have to hold true, but I just thought it was a good starting point. Now, if you notice, these brackets are not any wider than the tube, because I'm going to have frame tubes that this will be mounted to. And I think a good ballpark idea for this design is to have the width of the frame be about the same width as the swing arm. It doesn't have to be, but it doesn't, you shouldn't be very a lot wider. It shouldn't be a lot thinner than that or a lot narrower. So it's a good ballpark. All of that stuff obviously can change as we go, but that's how I developed this design. Now, it's not something I invented. I looked at other sources to see how other jack shafts were made. So this is a very simple, compact design. Again, the the engine will drive this sprocket will drive my wheel and tire, and hopefully we will oops, so I'm missing a few parts. Again, what I did here for this when I first started was I just made a plane on the surface of that sprocket. Then I looked at this alignment here. Surface of that sprocket. It's doing an offset here. Whatever I previously did, I have an offset to plane. Okay, so let me just stretch that out. So you see what I did is I'm not quite 100% there, but I'm going to make sure when I'm done that the outside, so this outside of the sprocket lines with that outside of the sprocket, and then I know that the chain is lined up. I know what I did. See, I added this bushing in here. So you don't want this steel sprocket rubbing against that steel tubing. So I added this bronze bushing here. So what I'm going to need to do is whatever the thickness of that bushing is, I'll go in and I'll edit that tube. So I'll just open up. I'll open up this drawing here and I'll just edit how wide this is. So whatever the width of the sprocket is, I'll just edit my extrusion there and then that'll correct it. So there'll be some back and forth. So that's how I arrived at the width of this really is based on where the sprocket is. So assemble this with the sprocket on there and find out what that situation is and then I'll just measure that spacing right there. Let's see if I want to go to the, that's the front face of that, right? So if I just go evaluate and I measure from the plane to that front face, it's going to tell me I already clicked on the wrong thing. Let's do that again. There, here we go. It's point. See that little black line? It's 0.11 inches. So that must be an eighth inch spacer. So what I got to do is go in and revise that drawing and make this tube 0.11 inches narrower. And then that sprocket will line up perfectly. And I just, when I did it, I just did it symmetrically. So I'll take the same amount off of that tube right there. So I have to go to that model of that tube, edit it, update it, and then everything should line up the way that I've got it all constrained. I've got each of these faces of each of these components constrained on here. Now I did the same thing here. I added a bushing there so the steel sprocket's not riding on the bearing. On my bearing, I just went to McMaster Car. Now I use a 3/4 shaft. I'm gonna go back in and verify that with the strength calculation. My one strength I should be a little bit concerned with would be the torsional shear strength of that. It's an easy calculation. I looked for a ball bearing and I wanted one that had a flange on it. So when I push it into that bracket, it'll rest against there so the bearing can't come out. So you'll have to go down here and find one that will fit on a 3/4 shaft. So just keep going down here to find a 3/4. And here we go. So there's one for a 3/4 shaft. For housing ID, so that'd be what I'm looking for. That would be the hole that the bearing is going to fit in. I could go with an inch and 5/8 or inch and 3/4. It's a half inch wide. Look at the strength of it too for loads. So it'll take a lot of load. That's good. And RPM, 2500 RPM is fine. It's a $17 bearing, so that's pretty good. I could go with that one. Now that number is important because that's going to match the bracket that you make. So if I choose that one and I can get, here's a nice drawing of it. It'll show you. So I'm just going to, when I design that bracket to hold it, I'll just know 2 inch hole. This is 9/16 thick. I think I made my bracket like 3/8 thick or something. And you can also, if you wanted to download a SOLIDWORKS file, that's fine. That's actually what I did, but it's not necessary. For a bearing, you could, this is a 5-minute part to model. Just make something with these dimensions. plug it in as a bearing. Okay, so that's where I got those bearings. That's also where I got the set collar. So once you have, if I turn that off, once you have this all put together, you want something to keep the shaft and the bearing from walking out. So if I put a set collar on the end of that shaft and a set collar on that shaft and lock them down, then the thing can't fall apart. The bearings can't fall out. So again, I just went to McMaster Car. Same with the sprockets. You can go to a manufacturer and look for sprocket. And we're going to use roller chain. I'm using number 35. Don't use number 25. 35 or number 40 is good for what we're doing. A number 35, that's a 3/8 pitch. So that's the diameter of the actual link of the chain. And I'm looking for something that'll fit on a 3/4 shaft. So if I come down here, there's an 11 tooth, there's a 12 tooth, 13 tooth. So maybe look at this diameter. So that should fit in there. If it's a 3/4 shaft, it's a 12. You may want to go a little bit bigger. Something like a 12 or 14 tooth for a 3/4 shaft. It's $13 if you come down here. Now again, it's going to have a drawing, which you could actually make your own drawing if you don't. If you don't grab a solid model from here, you can just make your own drawing. 3/8 pitch means that's the size of each of those pockets, and you know all the diameters that you need. There's the that will be the major diameter and the width and etc. Again, for our assemblies, we just need something to represent those parts. The bushings I just made, those are super simple little sketches and extrusions. It takes 2 minutes to do those. On the inside there, I did use those needle bearings. That fit inside there. Let's hide all this stuff. So those fit on the shaft, so I had to make sure that was a 3/4 ID. So needle bearings are nice because they're very, very compact. Let's see, I think I found them here in roller bearings. Yeah, so here's a needle, oops, don't use those, needle roller bearings. So they're very small, but they're good for rotating shafts. So again, we're looking, first look at the shaft size. I'm using a 3/4 shaft, so this would be fit a 1-inch ID, so that would be the OD of the bearing. So you'd have to have 1-inch inner diameter of your tube. So I ended up actually making the go back and I edited my tube so it was a little bit bigger diameter so that I could fit that in there. And you can see it'll handle the load, it'll handle definitely handle the RPM, 14,000 RPM. It's a $6 bearing. So that's really all you need. It's a 1/2 inch deep, 1 inch OD, 3/4 ID. So then I went to that arm and I just made a pocket in there so that that would fit. So I just made a new sketch on there. And it's a 1-inch OD. And then I did an extrude cut. What did we say? 1/2 inch. I did the same on the other side. Now, in order to do that, I had to change the OD of this thing because my original. Let's see, where is that original there. Yeah, I made it 1.125. It was 1 inch, which isn't going to work. So again, that's super easy to edit. Doesn't really harm anything. And then that'll allow me to fit that needle bearing inside of the tube. So you've got a bearing again. I know it's kind of confusing. There's two bearings on the end here, and that lets this shaft rotate freely, and those are your drive sprockets. And then I have this bearing goes between this shaft here and the swing arm, and that allows the swing arm to pivot freely. Because without that, if this shaft was being driven by the sprocket, the swing arm would have to be rotating around like crazy. So, right, that needle bearing fits inside there, and then I added the bushings so that you don't have steel on steel. I just added those little bushings. On all those interfaces, and you could probably purchase those, but again, super simple little sketch, and then insert them in there, stack it all up. I made this shaft here like 12 inches long to begin with, and then once I had everything stacked up, then I just went in and edited the length of the shaft so that fits. So it's really important that first of all you start out by lining up your sprockets and building it like that. So that's kind of a brief overview. Now I have a lot of stuff turned on and off and whatever, but that's a brief overview of that process that I went through to create this type of a jack shaft assembly.